Welcome back to SportsLine. We continue our college football preview 2018 with ESPN3's Bob Belvin, of course, also of ESPN Clarksville, broadcast games for the OVC all across the country. Guy knows his college football, so we're happy to have you here for the hour, man. It's been fun so far. All right, last segment we talked about Tennessee. Now we're going to switch gears and stay in the SEC East and talk about the Vanderbilt Commodores. And when you look at what Derek Mason has done 2 years ago, gets them to a bowl game. Last year, they start off on fire. You know, they beat Kansas State at home, first time they'd beaten a ranked FBS team in I don't know how long, and then things kind of went sour after that. What are your early thoughts on Vanderbilt coming into 2018?
I'm going to go real early with you.
Okay.
In your time here, have you felt there's been more important opener for Vanderbilt than this Saturday with Middle Tennessee coming to town?
You know what? Last year was right up there.
I felt like last year's
opener at Middle, I thought was very important for Derek Mason. But this year, I would say equally important.
Yeah.
I see where you're going with this.
I mean, by late Saturday night, this thing could be either out of kilter or could be going exactly in the direction that they need it. So, you know, then you got Nevada, and then you go to the Golden Dome on the 15th of September. I think, and I said it earlier, I think he's got one of the better quarterbacks in the Southeastern Conference in Kyle Shurmur. Can he keep Kyle Shurmur upright is the question. You know, and Shurmur just got beat up toward the end of the season last year.
Yeah, I was going to ask you, what do you think went wrong last year after that hot start? I mean, a lot of it had to do with Shurmur's play, and he didn't have a lot of time to throw. You're right, he got beat up a lot last year.
I saw some teammates in the routes kind of giving up or not finishing that. Just little nuances, and it's easy to sit here and say that, but when you just watch them, they just – you know, at some point in time when you win, you get a little bit of a swagger, even if it is an FCS opponent, start of the season, whatever.
Well, they called out Alabama last year, and I mean, obviously they were confident.
They had the swagger.
How did that turn out, right?
Well, and that's to your point, John, that's where that season really went down. You know, and I think that when they come through this season, hopefully, you know, they'll be a little less reserved when they have an opponent of that nature. But it's just important for them to get off to a good start. It's important for them to it's important for Kyle Shurmur to have an outstanding season, but you can't put all of it on him.
Right.
But you almost feel like you need to, because they're, you know, the running game is going to be okay. The defense should be better than it was last season. It's got six or seven starters coming back this season, but it's going to be a tough road for them.
No question. But one of the things I think Derek Mason did that I thought was very noteworthy is giving up defensive coordinator/play-calling duties. I mean, and he said, now I have an opportunity to be a game day manager. I don't have to just concentrate on the defense. I can be a head coach, a game day manager. I think that could be a big factor as to how successful Vanderbilt is this year.
I agree with you. And conversely, and just to interject just a little bit more orange,
sure,
think about Jeremy Pruitt and how he's going to react being a coordinator, national championship coordinator, the ring, the whole deal. So, yeah, I think for Derek Mason, I he's just a fantastic guy.
Yeah.
And I think he is going to embrace that 10,000, 15,000-foot view instead of just being kind of micro to the defensive side of the ball. Mm-hmm. That's where he came from, right? And all those coaches want to go back to that. That's comfort for all of us.
Sure.
But I think that decision is big, and I think it speaks to moving not totally into a CEO role, but I think it speaks to being more of the overseer, not necessarily the game manager, that's an overused cliche too, but just to be able to see it in a different way, I think it's real important, and I think that may be the difference in this team.
Well, you mentioned Kyle Shurmur, you're right. I think he's one of the more underrated quarterbacks in the country, let alone the SEC. Here's a guy that started a lot of games, so you have a comfort level there. Ralph Webb is gone, he's with the Patriots now, and so now it looks like Kari Blasingame, it may be running back by committee, but I think Kari Blasingame will probably step in to be the lead running back. He's bigger than Ralph. He's more of a power runner. They used him in short yardage and goal line this year. Now he's got to carry the load. Do you think he has the goods to carry the mail for the black and gold?
He does. And some of that, man, Ralph Webb, wow.
Oh.
What a great
player, great guy.
Great player, great guy, great fit for that program, great fit for the offense.
Just like Zach Stacy was before him, right?
Yeah, you forget about that, right? You forget about how good the running backs have been there at Vanderbilt. And so the big question is why? Well, the offensive line, I think, has improved this season. I think Blasingame, you know, he needs to get 800 to 1,000 yards a season. I think that's where he needs to be numerically. Don't like talking about stats so late in August, but I think that's where he's got to be.
Yeah,
I think he's got to be in 80, 75, 80 yards a game kind of average to be able to give them a chance. Clearly, it's got to be a little more ball control. If you can get back to a little bit of the old school, control the ball, not turn it over, all of those cliches. But in Vanderbilt's sense, I think if you can really control time of possession, I think the defense will get you where you need to be.
I agree because, and tell me where you come out on this, Bob, I just don't know if Vanderbilt has enough playmakers on the outside in the passing game. You know, I mean, Jordan Matthews is not walking through that door, and they've had, you know, some pretty good tight ends go through there, but I haven't really been overly impressed by what I've seen from the wide receiver position. Where do you come out on
that?
Well,
I agree, and that's another area where I like to look at, too, is to look at the SEC East. The defenses in the SEC East are extremely talented at the corners, primarily, so that limits you and what you're going to do because you've got to play all those guys, right?
Mm-hmm.
I think a shorter passing game, I think you could come out in the season with Vanderbilt and see maybe 15 passes of 30 yards or more, the chunk plays that you talk about from the back. I think it's probably a max of what you would see throughout the whole season long. So just limit the shorter game, shorter throwing game, limit the routes, I think, and make the passing game a little bit more like a running game as well, kind of complimentary, quick hitches, quick flares out to the outside, you know, and a little bit of that, you know, if we can average 4.5 yards per play on that, I think they'd be very happy with that.
Defensively, they lose some studs. Obviously, Burks is gone, but you said you think they'll be a good unit this year. What gives you that confidence?
Well, I think their linebackers and their names escape me right now, but I think there's some strength in the middle of the field with that linebacker core. The secondary is still a little bit young when you look at it, but again, I think they're going to improve as the season goes on. You know, Middle Tennessee, Nevada, the first two games, that's a good kind of, and then, you know, like I said, then you get to the Golden Domers, but I think you got an opportunity there to improve early in the season and kind of let that, it's kind of like spring training, right?
The
pitchers are ahead of the batters or whichever way it goes. I think that's where it is. So I think defensively they'll be better, but it'll have to be one of those body of work kind of things.
As we said, Vanderbilt will open at home late Saturday afternoon against Middle Tennessee. These teams have had some great games over the last couple of years, some close ones. Last year, not so much. Shermer throwing for 296
really
and three touchdowns. Roth Webb had a strong game. I expect a close game Saturday. How about you?
I do, and I think it'll benefit both teams if it's a close game, really, because both of these teams, I don't think Middle is as talented as they've been in seasons past. I think both of these teams are going to have an approach throughout the season. If I can get midway late in the fourth quarter and I'm in the game, that's where I want to be. I need that one little jolt of a play to kind of get me over the top. I think Vanderbilt has the edge in that game just simply because of their personnel and talent.
Sure.
On average is better than Middle Tennessee in that situation. Rick Stockstill, what a tough job to coach your son.
Yeah.
And it's been flawless.
It's been absolutely flawless. Like, it's, you know, it's weird because it's not really a father-son deal when they get on the field. It's
business.
Coach and quarterback.
Yeah.
You know, and both guys acknowledge that. You're right. And you look what Middle did last year, going into Syracuse and beating my Orange. That's basically my hometown. You know, they go to the Dome and they beat Syracuse. So on any given day, they can beat anybody.
Yeah, they have. And that, their conference is a little bit down. If you read the trade journals, right? The conference is a little bit down.
Right.
So
USA.
I think it's an opportunity for them to kind of to move up a little bit and improve. But Stockstill's, you know, Brent is the key to that.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, we forget he had a season-ending injury a couple seasons ago and kind of shelved him. And you know, we don't maybe talk a lot about the comeback from that injury that he had.
Mm-hmm.
And then we compare that to Kyle Shermer, whom, you know, I commented earlier, if they could just keep him upright, Vanderbilt could keep him upright. We've got a big opportunity there. So that's going to be a fun game I'm going to keep an eye on too. That's be right at the end of the Tennessee game, so we can just kind of
It's going to be a full day of football watching, folks. And when you look at Middle Tennessee, you're right. You know, Stockstill goes down, misses a ton of games. but they were able to rally late in the season, make a bowl game, get a bowl win, and that was huge for that program. Making a bowl and B, finally getting a bowl win, because we've seen them lose some bowl games the last couple of years.
In my opinion, John, Middle Tennessee has such opportunity in that conference. Mm-hmm. I think their facilities are top notch in compared to others. When they made that move to FCS, mm-hmm. A lot of folks questioned them, and it's been hard. And you talked about how hard it is to win at the collegiate level, at that level, mm-hmm. to make that move. And yeah, that seems like an eternity ago. It was about 10, 12 years ago when they made that move, right? And so ever since then, it's been a slow building process. I'm not going to say this is Rick Stockstill's most talented team, but I think they've got a better than average chance inside of Conference USA.
And I think,
save Memphis.
Right, and I think Stock is one of those coaches that maybe the less talented the team is, the more he can get in there and kind of coach them up a little bit and then get them to overachieve a little bit. Would not be surprised if that were the case this year.
It seems like yesterday he was still a quarterback in Bobby Bowden's FSU team. I mean, really, And I look at him and he's got a son playing in the quarterback for him.
Oh, my goodness. Where does the time go?
It's really been a while, and it's hard to believe.
Well, speaking of time, it's time for another break. When we come back, Bob and I are going to break down the SEC. Right now it looks like Georgia and Alabama, but maybe some other teams could surprise. A lot of new coaches in the conference this year. We're going to break that down for you as we continue our college football preview right here on SportsLine. Stay with us.